What is the matter? She said, this is the same dancer who embraced Islam on your hands. Life and death question. Life and death. I said, what happened? Your family became your attempt to? So we did a mashura what to do to our other friends. Do we ever do a mashura dancing? I don't think we do. These are the new Muslims who have brought Islam by conviction. So she said, we decided to get the men in one house and the women in one house of my husband's family and my family. You see, I was to address the men, women, and my husband was to address the women. There is no mixed part in Islam. From the beginning of Islam, she understood Utfulu Bisil Rakafa. There is no mixed party. There is no exposing of the body. She said, from that day, I threw away the bikini, I threw away that vizier, and I made clothes, Muslim clothes, long sleeves, right up to the neck, covered my head with a scarf. You see, put on the burqa with the veil in front of the face, which many Muslim girls don't do today, unless she's very religious. And she said, Colonel Sahab, we were traveling in the car. When the car moved fast, my burqa sleeve slipped 4 inches. Then she started to cry. Colonel Sahab, will this flesh burn in hellfire? What answer can we give, my dear brother? He was traveling right up in the sky, and I was standing on the ground. I said, my dear sister, I can assure you that it will not burn in hellfire. Your thought is enough to save you from hellfire and going to paradise. But tell me what I should do for future. I said, put an elastic on the end of your sleeve so that it will not move in future. That is the result of the tabligh and da'wat. Another woman, my own mother, who embraced Islam by seeing Kaaba in a dream. May Allah excuse me, I am not telling this to boast. But very strict Muslim, she gets up 1:30 in the night till the sun rises without fail. And if I come tired from the tabligh, she said, Sunny, it is 3 o'clock now, time to get up. Your tabligh is useless without crying in the night. You see, Ya ayyuhal muzzammil, she knows that surah also. Ya ayyuhal muzzammil, fumin la ilaha illa khalira nisfa. You see, stand up in the night. Otherwise you are like a dead body marching on the shoulders of war. So she once looked at my father, who comes from the family of the Prophet, 7 generations of the Quran. And she said, Nawab Sahab, do you love the Prophet or do you love the enemies of the Prophet? I want one answer from you. So he said, I come from the Prophet's family, I love the Prophet. She said, but you do not follow the ways of the Prophet. You do not dress like him, you are educated in Scotland, and so you follow the ways of the West. She said, you go and tabligh for 40 days, here is the money. I have sold some of my jewelry and I have kept money for you. You go in tabligh like your son goes. Maulana Yusuf Rahmatullah was alive then. So he went in tabligh. And when he was going in tabligh, he removed all things, you see, which would ruin his outward appearance as a Muslim. And told me, I have taken away all those things which will ruin the outward appearance of your father. And then my father came back with the long kurta and the turban and a big beard. And then my mother said, now, Nawab Sahab, you recite the kalma la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah again. Now you have become a Muslim. This is the effect of tabligh and da'wat, my dear friends and brothers. Don't think tabligh and da'wat to be an ordinary thing. No. We were coming back from America. And this was the first year in America for Jamaat, 1971. In that 1 year, 200 people embraced Islam on my hands. Of course, may Allah excuse me, I'm not boasting. It is just to show Tabligh and Dawat, the abyss of Tabligh and Dawat, 3,600 people embraced Islam on my hands during my 10 years stay in America. And many of them are now Maulvis, Hafiz of Quran, their children are Hafiz of Quran. You see, now one of them is teaching in the University of Medina, in the University of Jeddah. You see, one has been martyred in the path of Allah. You see, that is due to the brilliant Dawat. So, after spending 4 months, you see, there were 5 women also. 4 went back with their husbands after putting on the burqa and niqab and everything, which is unknown in America. And after that, my dear friends and brothers, you see, one woman and her husband remained. He came with us. We landed in New York. We were 17 people. Everybody was wearing the turban without exception. Everybody had the long kurta up to the half of the shin bone, the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Big beards, and most of the Americans wear the lungi. They don't put on even shalwar. They wear the lungi. And they are funny people. They put on the miswak here in the upper pocket. You see? And they have a tasbi in their head. When the emigration started, we looked at the 17 people, and every one of those Americans stood 6'4". Everybody was over 6 feet except Abdul Rahman. Abdul Rahman was a small chap. He was martyred in 1979 in Makkah and gone straight into Jannah, inshallah, summa inshallah. Anyhow, you see, they put the passport numbers in the computer. Nothing came out. Okay. So they now thought, what to do? Who are these ruffians? They had never seen Muslims in that dress before. So they told me, who is the leader? I said, hi. He said, we? Who are you people? I said, we are Muslims, followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Arey, we have seen people from Pakistan, India, from all countries of the world. We have never seen this dress and this big beard and this turban. What nonsense is this? I said, look, we are American and Canadian citizens. You mark your language. Speak in civil language and parliamentary language and do not exceed your bounds. We are not afraid of you. Yes, you have to be strict with these fellows. So he said, all right. Then he called Maryam and Abdul Rahman. These both had embraced Islam on my hands. You see? And told Maryam, you lift your veil. We want to see your face and compare with your passport. She said, what? What? I am a Muslim. I am a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I have just been for 4 months. I sitting in the Talim read that Umme Salma and Maimona radiallahu ta'ala anhuma could not come in front of a blind man. In fact, Rasulullah sallam told me, Sajaba, go into Parda. And Maimona radiallahu ta'ala anha said, he is blind, he cannot see us. And Rasulullah said, you both are not blind, you can see him. So I am a follower of that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if you want to know. I cannot lift my veil even if I am shot dead. You understand, my dear friends? The effect of Tabligh and Dawat. Then they looked at me. I said, don't look at me. Don't look at me. You send for your police. Women police. So they said, this has never happened in America. I said, if you want Muslim women to cross your border, you see, then you better get your women police. Don't argue with me. So they said, okay. So then they got a woman police. Then I was standing behind the, you know, that corridor with the rods and all, and Maryam and her husband were that side. I took up my, you see, tasbih, and very feeble voice, I said, Abdul Rahman, tell your wife, do dhikr of Allah. His brother shouted at the top of his voice, Maryam, do the dhikr of Allah in front of Allah. America, Russia, China, and the whole world put together is not even equal to the wing of a mosquito. You understand? That is the iman which you get from Tabligh and Dawat. Then, my dear friends and brothers in Islam, the women police carried Maryam this side and Abdul Rahman was carried away by the men police. Then they went inside, and later on I heard from Abdul Rahman, because Maryam in the beginning used to talk to me, but after when she became a good Muslim and she started to wear the veil, then she wanted to ask anything. She used to tell Abdul Rahman, ask Colonel Sahab what we should do. She never talked direct to me. So Abdul Rahman told me that when she went inside, you see, the police woman said, lift your veil. She lifted her veil. She showed the photo. The police woman said, okay. At once she pulled her veil in front of the face. So the police woman said, I can understand you hiding your face from men. I cannot understand you hiding your face from women. She said, you are not a woman. I apologize, but you are not a woman. You are dressed to kill. You are dressed in a small frock. You have got rouge, lipstick. Your hair is going up like a mountain in the air. And you are doing this not for your husband, to distract the eyesight, you see, of others. So your heart is not quite clean. It has become black. If I do not hide myself from you, your blackness will come onto my heart, and then I will return to my normal self, which I was before going in Tabligh and now. You understand, my dear friends and brothers? So, Rasooli Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he trained his ummah on these lines. And whoever will follow these lines, he will get the same deen as the Sahaba had. Of course, no one, the greatest wali, cannot equal the dust of the shoes of the Sahabas. Because they were great people. You see, after the Prophet, the greatest people are the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You see, we will try to copy them instead of copying the Western world. Then we will do hijrat, inshallah. Hijrat in the real sense of the word. From our customs, from our ways of life, from our dresses, from our ways of eating, from our ways of living, and follow the pattern, letter for letter, consonant for consonant, word for word, step for step of Muhammad bin Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then we get hidayat. Why to see who taqadu? And when we get hidayat, amal will rise to such a pitch that inshallah, summa inshallah, as the Sahabas, in the days of the Sahabas, when they strived 150 times in the path of Allah, then they had an iman unparalleled in the history of mankind. With that iman, amal unparalleled in the history of mankind. With that, they had the Persian Empire under the right foot and the Roman Empire under the left foot, and they walked into Bayt al-Maqdis without fighting. Umar radiallahu ta'ala had his shoes dangling on the shoulder, you see, and his feet were filled in mud. He had the big black beard and the black turban, and his slave was mounted on the camel, and his burqa had 17 patches. And he was holding the rein of the camel, and Abu Ubaidah came and told him, brother, how can you go in front of these civilized people in this fashion? He took up the sand and threw it in the face of Abu Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala. He said, Abu Ubaidah, if you are not so exalted in the eyes of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was known as Aminul Ummat, the trustee of the Ummat, I would have given such a punishment, no Muslim would have uttered these words till doomsday. And then he said, listen carefully, inna kunna adallana a'azzana Allah bil Islam law nahnu natlubu al-izza bi ghayri ma a'azzana Allah adallana Allah. He said, you see, that we were the most disgraced of mankind. Allah rose us to the height of honor through the medium of Islam. Those people are thinking of any other medium, mark the words of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Who was Umar? La nabiyya ba'di, law kana nabiyyan ba'di, kana Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. there is no prophet after me. If there had been a prophet, Umar was, had the ability to become a prophet. He said, we were the most disgraced of mankind. Allah rose us to the height of honor through the medium of Islam. If you dare to forsake the medium of Islam and try any other means, Allah will pour disgrace onto your head. My dear friends and brothers, not only that, when Dawat was on the top of the heads of the Muslims, you see, this is written by Maulana Yusuf Rahmatullah Alayh. It is in Hadith Bukhari also. It is not an over boundary. If you want to refer the third volume of Hayatul Sahaba, chapter 9, you will see that a shepherd was grazing his sheep. A wolf came from the back and got hold of the sheep. Then this shepherd, he took a stick, whacked on the head of the wolf, and he stabbed his sheep back. The sheep sat down, and in the Arabic language, human language, he said, this is my risk from Allah. Who are you to take it? The shepherd got surprised. He said, what? You are a wolf and you are talking in the human language. He said, there is nothing to be surprised. You go to Medina. You are on the border of Medina. You go to Medina and you will see a person who is talking of what is happening in the heavens and what is happening below the earth. When you hear that, you will be still more surprised. So the shepherd packed up his goods and ran with his flock to the corner of Medina. He put his sheep there. You see? And then he went inside and saw the beautiful countenance of Muhammad bin Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shining like the full moon. Broad shoulders, big eyes. When he smiled, his teeth used to smile, shine like pearls. The black beard and the hair coming down to the lower part of the ear. From there he shouted, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka rasulullah. I bear witness to the fact there is no one worthy of worship except Allah. And you are the correct prophet of Allah. Because he did not know the name, he said, Ashhadu annaka rasulullah. Rasulullah called him, come here. Who told you? He said, the bear, the wolf told me, the wolf. He said, Bilal, go and call all the Sahabas. All the Sahabas came. He told the shepherd, you mount the pulpit. Now describe to them the invocation of the wolf. My dear friends and brothers, the reason for telling this is that when the belief in Dawat was number one in the lives of the Sahabas, they did not adjust the belief in Dawat with their affairs. They adjusted their affairs with the belief in Dawat. Then the wolf, the animal doctor used to testify to La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the understanding to take up this dawat. You see, before it is too late. You see, and my last thing to you is, in the days of Hadrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, three big sahabis, Abu Sufyan رضي الله تعالى سحيل بن عمر رضي الله تعالى and أكرم بن أبي جهل رضي الله تعالى. These were the people who entered Islam after Fatih Makkah. He gave the Khadim of Umar رضي الله تعالى came and said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, these people have come, the chieftains of Quraysh, the first of Persia, Salman رضي الله تعالى, the first of the Ghifari class, Abu Zar Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala, have come. Hadith Umar dropped his book, dropped door. From there he shouted, A'ajaban ala ibn al-Khattab, yadawuna wa yadu abidan. What is wrong with Umar ibn al-Khattab? He is calling our slaves forward and pushing us, the chieftains, back to the door. Something wrong with his thinking. Sahel bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala was very zaki, very clever person. He said, لا تغضبوا على ابن القتال. إنما أوتيتم هذا من قبل أنفسكم. إنما دعانا الإسلام دعوان مستويا فصدقوا فصدقوا. He said that Islam present day, we have brought this day on ourselves due to our own folly. Islam presented an equal invitation in front of those people whom you are calling your slaves and in front of us whom you are calling the teachers. They went forward and Allah put them forward. Then the countenance of Umar radiallahu ta'ala changed. He said, Abu Sufyan, what do you think yourself? This is not my decision. If Abu Bakr Siddiq would have been, he would have given the same decision. If Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have been here, he would have given the same decision. And on the day of judgment, Allah will give the same decision. These fellows will be in the first rank behind Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are lucky to be standing near the door. Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl have fallen into the fire. So my dear friends and brothers, after touring 40 countries of the world for 35 years, let me tell you, still after some time, you see, my dear brothers, there might be a selection. There may be a selection. People will be asking, what are you? Are you an army? What are your qualifications? You see? Then it will be difficult. Now everybody is being accepted. This is the time to grasp the opportunity and stand up with courage. What will happen? Let me tell you what will happen. What will happen? Rufiyat al-aqlam wa juffat al-suhuf. The pens have been lifted and the ink is dry. What is going to happen is written. You see? Suppose a loss is written for us, a loss from Allah. If we go out in the path of Allah and then lose, it will be lost in the path of Allah. And the there. If we don't go out, it still will lose. But in the path of Allah, will not be combined with it. It will be a material loss without a reward of the hereafter. So destiny is fixed. It cannot be changed. This is the time. This is the time to make everything that is valueless valuable. So, with courage, I really tell you, South Africa is a place in which people know English, Urdu, Arabic. There are many people in your country that know English, Arabic. And we in America and Canada are devoid, you see, of any such people. And people are thirsty. I was in Wichita just now. A couple came from 130 miles and said, we heard that you are in Wichita and you can explain Islam in English. Americans. You see, and with her was an Arab friend. I said, madam, I think that there is something wrong with your mind. She said, no, nothing wrong. I said, then your question seems to be very wrong. You are a Muslim and you want to say that you want to undergo it. Started to cry. She said, my dear friend, I came only to understand. Now I have understood. I want to embrace Islam immediately. There and then she embraced Islam, you see. And then I told her, for your safeguard, it's better that you get married to a Muslim. So that Arab brother said, I'm prepared to pick. Some girls went to Makkah. And now they are staying in Makkah with their husbands. And they have created such a hubbub in Makkah. You see, they are observing the full parda. They are not going outside their house. Being American.